Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of Inforum, a division of the Commonwealth Club by and for people in their 20s and 30s with a mission to inspire debate on civic issues. You can find us online at commonwealthclub.org/inforum. As Caroline mentioned, I'm Leslie Gueverra. I'm an associate editor at Greener World Media and tonight's moderator. Tonight we're here to explore green building technologies, and when it comes to pollution, it's very easy to blame cars. But buildings alone are responsible for a great deal of our nation's greenhouse gas emissions, and that's why many people believe that they are the key to successfully combating global climate change, and that it requires really innovative land use planning and structuring our cities to remove buildings as energy wasters. We're very lucky in having speakers who are thought leaders on this subject, and we hope to give you ideas that you can take away with you, either as decision makers, business people, and of course as average citizens, so you can join this mission of going to zero emissions. So on my immediate left is Edward Mazria. He's an internationally recognized architect, author, educator, and visionary with a long and distinguished career. His award-winning architecture and planning projects span more than a 35-year period, and each employs a cutting-edge environmental approach to design. Peter Calthorpe, next to Ed, is the principal of Calthorpe Associates and was named one of the 25 innovators on the cutting edge by Newsweek magazine for his work redefining the models of urban and suburban growth in this country. And on my far left in the stunning red shirt is David Assmann. He is the deputy director for San Francisco's Department of Environment. And as you know, San Francisco is one of the more progressive cities in the United States and has a very aggressive policy toward not only greening its cities, but the habits and behaviors of its inhabitants. Gentlemen, thank you very much for being with us tonight. As I let you know, our ideal is to tell you where we are in terms of reducing greenhouse gas emissions in the built environment, where we need to be, what our barriers are, and what you can do to help things move the needle. Gentlemen, each of you has a different approach to this particular strategy. Would each of you answer for our audience, where are we right now?
We're far behind, as far as we can tell.
Why is that, Ed?
The building sector was responsible for 48% of all energy consumption in the country a few years ago. It's now up to 50.1%. So it's actually increasing and becoming the lion's share of energy consumption. So in order to meet any greenhouse gas emissions reduction targets, or even go to reduce our energy consumption, we need to get a handle on the building sector. We need to get a handle on all sectors. They all feed into the building sector, but we definitely need to approach the building sector in a different way.
Okay. Now, David, how should we be approaching the building sector? Now, I know each of you have a different take on that, so we're going to bring the question back around that way. But what should we be doing?
Well, what we should be doing is we should be looking at existing buildings. We should be looking not just at new construction, because we've had some pretty innovative legislation here and elsewhere that addresses new construction in terms of efficiency. But we need to go one step further and say, well, it's not the new buildings that are going to make the difference in the long run. It's going to be taking what's already there and making those buildings more efficient. So that should be a focus here and elsewhere. Really, we need to do things on a state and national level. We can only go so far on a regional level. That's where the action needs to be.
Now, are we talking about houses? Are we talking about commercial buildings? Or are we talking about both?
Both, absolutely both. I mean, you can't do one and ignore the other. I mean, our building stock is our building stock. It houses both. We need to look at both commercial. We need to look at residential. We need to make substantial changes, and we need to do it fast. And we're on a slow track. I absolutely agree with Ed. We're far behind where we need to be. If we need to have an impact on climate change, we need to accelerate our efforts by orders of magnitude. I mean, climate impacts really take about 30 years to manifest themselves. That if you look at emissions and the ultimate climate impact, what we're seeing today is what happened in the 1980s. And we need to really move forward. I mean, there is a school of thought already that says the battle against climate change is over and we've lost the battle. What we can only do right now is mitigate the impact of what's coming to hit us. So we need to move a lot faster than we have been. It's not a disastrous situation. I don't want to paint a doom and gloom scenario, but I am saying that we need to address this with urgency, and we need to throw out the old conventions and say we need to have innovative policies, and we need to have them fast to reverse the trends that we have had over the last 50 and more years.
Okay, Peter, do you think we can do this in 30 years? Do you think it could be done in a generation?
You know, I don't know, but I'd like to answer your original
Please.
Question, which is, where are we? We're in the midst of a huge recession. And why are we there? We like to think it's because some devils in Wall Street concocted some debt mechanisms that we couldn't handle. I think the reality is we've reached the end of a particular era in terms of what the American dream means in this country. The idea that everybody has a single-family home on a cul-de-sac and has three cars in the garage basically came to an end, I think, with the meltdown of the real estate segment of the economy. There's a larger meaning to that, which I hope we don't miss at this moment as the stock market starts to climb and everybody thinks, well, everything's okay, we're going to go back to the way things were. The reality is what we've been building, this sprawl fabric, which is really the epicenter of our carbon emissions and a whole bunch of other environmental impacts and equity issues, doesn't fit who we are anymore. And to a certain degree, what happened last year with the implosion of real estate values was the market said, people don't value this stuff, people can't sustain this stuff economically, it's too expensive, and there's too much of one size fits all to make it valuable to the community. So the fundamental reboot in how we build communities is now, I think, in order. And it's a bigger thing than just solving emissions. I mean, you can count tons of greenhouse gas emissions, and you can do all the calculations about how this is going to do that. But in reality, we have a larger purpose to serve here, which is to get our communities back to a place where they really function in a way that's satisfying to everybody and meaningful.
Now that means changing people's expectations as well as their behaviors. How are we going to do that?
I think it's overdue. People are waiting for it to happen. You know, there was a fellow named Nelson who in 06 did a study that looked at housing demand in the year 2025, discovered that large lot single family, we've already built enough to satisfy the need for large lot single family, which of course we know is one of the biggest culprits in terms of carbon emissions, both in terms of travel behavior and building energy consumption. We've built too much of that. And the market demand is now for more urban living, for more walkable communities, for more compact buildings, which naturally become more efficient buildings.
Naturally? Ed, what do you think about
I think what Peter's talking about is what's mm-hmm. happening anyway. We're urbanizing. We're 80% urbanized in this country. Now we've been moving.
If you call sprawl urban.
Well, we've been moving in that direction. And I agree with Peter. We need boundaries, and we can't just keep expanding infrastructure. It just gets too costly, and cost is going to be a big issue. There's legislation now, I think very important legislation, that was passed out of the House. Whether you like cap and trade or you don't like cap and trade, there is a building section, an incredible building section, in the Waxman bill. It's called Section 201, and it's one or two sections above and below that that deals specifically with the building sector. It's probably some of the best legislation I've ever seen. That legislation is now being crafted, the Senate version, we need to make sure that the Senate version is as good as the House version, and that's something that we can all do right now. We need to put pressure on the Senate to make sure that they craft something that is as good as the House bill. Most of the stuff is the building section part is not crafted yet. It's actually in the works now. We see some really good things happening, and we see some things that are not as good as the House side, but we need to keep on top of that and make sure we get a good bill.
Ed, before we move on, what are the good things and what are the not so good things that you're seeing?
Well, the good things in the House bill is that they crafted a code section, and it's a national building code section that follows the 2030 challenge timelines that we instituted back in 2003, 2004, and then we made it public in 2006. They basically took that and put it into the bill. So there are some great reduction targets and great timelines, starting with a 30% reduction below our best energy codes now, starting immediately, going to 50% below in 2015, 2016, and then 5% better increments all the way out to 2030, so that we begin to move by between now and 2030 to zero net energy energy buildings. And we can get there a lot of different ways. One of the ways that Peter's talking about is density. You start putting buildings together, having common walls, things like that. It's much easier to meet the targets than if you're spread out. So there's a lot happening at the national level that's very, very exciting, and we need to stay on top of that and make sure it gets through.
But there's a lot happening at the state level here. I mean, we passed a law that set carbon emission targets, which is the most aggressive in the country. And to achieve it, there's a laundry list of of things that we have to do, and there's no one silver bullet. But in our state here, 50% of emissions come from cars. We did a good job back in the 70s. Ed and I were hanging out together in those days, and those energy standards got incorporated into something we did called Title 24. So we've been actually building some pretty intelligent buildings in this state for that period of time, and it shows. We have the lowest energy consumption and carbon emissions of any state in the country. We don't have great education results these days, but that's a whole other topic to get into. So, you know, we've done that, and we need to do more of it. We now need to solve the car problem in California in order to get to those AB 32 standards. And the only way to do that is to have regional plans that really begin to coherently shape development around transit and walkable places. Until you create viable environments for people that allow them to get out of their car, they're not gonna get out of their car. And until they get out of their car, yes, we can drive Priuses, but that's only gonna get us halfway there. It's not gonna get us to where we need to be if we wanna be at 80% of 1990, which is the global desire line. So, and it's what we absolutely need. So there's, as I keep saying, there's a fundamental lifestyle shift in this. It's not just adding insulation in the attic and putting solar collectors on the roof and buying a hybrid. It's fundamentally changing the way we live towards a more urban lifestyle, which happily is pretty much what the demographics are pushing us towards anyway.
David, what do you think about that? San Francisco is kind of an interesting community in that it speaks to a lot of what Peter is saying, but it also can be a very obstreperous community as well.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, we're talking about obstacles in the way of things like height limits. There's objection to further densification of San Francisco. We certainly have some obstacles from that perspective. And the two are really tied together, transportation and housing, in the sense if you've got to integrate the two together. You can't take one and address it without the other. We have so many people moving in, coming in from outside the city to work here, and at the same time having a lot of people that live in the city going outside of the city to work outside of the city, and that trend has to be reversed. Because it's not enough to build a dense urban center and then have people still commute elsewhere. So you need to make it advantageous for those people who live in an area to also work in the area, and you have to have incentives. You've also got to deal with, in San Francisco's case, the situation where 70% of our housing is occupied by renters. There's not the incentive for building owners or managers to do energy efficiency improvements, for example, if they don't see the benefits from that. If tenants pay energy bills, but the efficiency improvements can't be made by tenants, you're never going to see those improvements.
Because there's no percentage in it.
There's no percentage in it for renters. So you've got to address things on a bunch of different levels. You've got to address things from a perspective of what is the incentive and how can you incentivize change? How can you set up financing mechanisms that work for both tenants and landlords? How can you incentivize people living and working in the same area? If housing prices continue to increase inside San Francisco, you're pricing out a significant percentage of the population. They can't live here, even if they work here. So you've got to address that as well. So there's a whole range of challenges that one has to overcome on a local level.
Let me expand on that, because I think that's a really, really key issue, this jobs housing balance issue. When you see it from the perspective of San Francisco alone, actually, even if everybody in the city worked in the city, that still wouldn't fill all the jobs in the city. So you have to look at the jobs housing on a regional scale. When you look at it on a regional scale in the Bay Area, we're not satisfying our housing needs. And people are driving from the Central Valley and Santa Cruz and, you know, out and beyond because we're unwilling to build housing. And that has its roots in lots of interesting sociological phenomena, NIMBYism, and to a certain degree, the environmental community is at fault here for saying, we don't want more development here, we want more open space. That's very nice for the people who live here, but the reality is we want the jobs, but we don't want the housing. The asymmetry here is tremendous. I mean, you know, it is unusual in the whole country to have this situation, but we are job rich. We're one of the most innovative places on the planet. We're going to continue to generate jobs, but we're unwilling to generate the housing to match those jobs. And that kind of asymmetry is really systemic and really a problem.
Peter, I'd like to get Ed's opinion on this, first of all. Help us pull back just a little bit so we get a more macro view. We've been talking very much about the Bay Area and very much about San Francisco, but you can also bring a national and an international perspective to us, because it's not all just here. There's a bigger world out there, and what do we need to do to expand our
region? Let's talk nationally for a second, because I think, you know, Peter makes a good point. Right now, there's no building going on. So building in this country is pretty much shut down. That's both good and bad. It drags the whole economy down because pretty much every industry is tied to building. So if you take the building sector down, you take every industry down, from paint and fabrics to metals and wood. The opportunity is that because it's dormant right now, we have an opportunity to bring it back in a whole new way, and that is key. If we bring the building sector back, both locally and nationally, and even internationally, the same old way, we're going to be in deep trouble, because every time you add a square foot to the global building footprint, you're adding energy consumption and greenhouse gas emissions. So we have an opportunity now to do that. So we need actually the federal government to put in place incentives to bring the building sector back in a whole new way. That means to incentivize location-efficient mortgages, to incentivize people to renovate, to where not only do they put people back to work and the federal government gets its money back in taxes, mm-hmm. but they have more expendable income and they've reduced their energy consumption and emissions. So the federal government has an opportunity now to put in place, with some of the money it still has from its TARP funds or its buying of mortgage-backed securities, it still has plenty of operating room to begin to address the building sector, to bring it back in a whole way that's completely different than business as usual. Because I can tell you, if we set emissions targets for 2020, 2030, and then out to 2050, and we need to be 83% below 2005 levels or 80% below 1990 levels, which are about the same, you cannot get there if you bring the building sector back in the same way it was when it took a dive.
We're talking a lot about government. David, you're in government. Is this putting too much burden on it in terms of responsibility?
Well, I think that government has the responsibility. It is our responsibility to do things that benefit the public good. I think that it's not going to happen if government doesn't get involved. At the same time, government needs to be supported. It needs to be pressured. These things aren't going to happen on their own. Policymakers are not going to take actions that are immensely unpopular. So it needs the support in order for that to happen. I think the proper place for these changes to happen is with the use of government incentives and government plans and programs and requirements. But at the same time, it's not going to happen if there's massive opposition to these programs and plans as well. So it's a responsibility, but it will only happen if there's also support and pressure.
You know, the issue also is the right scale of government. We rarely talk about this. We take as a given that we have national, state, and local. And the reality is we lead regional lives. Our job opportunities are regional, our airshed, our watershed, our environment. Mm-hmm. Everything is more and more regional. We lead regional lives, and yet we don't have a regional governance system that orchestrates that in an efficient way. And that's what I see as one of the greatest failings. And so it's not just saying that the feds or the state or the cities should do X, Y, and Z, although they need to, absolutely, but that we need a way of thinking about ourselves and governing ourselves at a scale that fits the reality of today. When you look at the global economy, it's regions that are the primary actors, not states and nations. And so this idea of regional governance, I think, is really key to not only solving environmental problems, but a lot of our social equity issues. And you know, how we distribute affordable housing is a regional issue, not a statewide or a citywide issue. And so I think using this opportunity, this pause, as Ed said, as a way of not only rebooting the standards by which we build, but the way in which we think about shaping communities is essential. And so I think it's starting to happen. That's why SB 375 in the state of California is so seminal. It's finally said, yes, the regional governments have a really important role to play in fulfilling a future that's environmentally sustainable.
So, Peter, you would think that the air district model, for example, that now exists should be expanded and cover other areas, that's the right level at which one should be making and implementing these policies?
Airsheds, watersheds, commute sheds perhaps are the most important one of all. You know, what are our travel behaviors around and open space networks? They don't, you know, they're very important on very local levels, and yet linking it all together, what Greenbelt Alliance is attempting to do here, to say you have to think about our open space systems in a holistic way, the regional scale, all those begin to add value to how we shape our communities, not as, you know, individual private affairs, but as larger common good.
Yeah, I also think that you mentioned earlier the conflict between open space and density. I don't think there's necessarily a conflict. It's how you design the open space and how you design the density. You can still have open space as long as you densify it a little bit more in the areas that are not open.
They're totally complementary. The more we move towards urban patterns of development and density, the less pressure we put on our open space systems. Okay.
And actually, a question you asked earlier about changing expectations.
Exactly.
Changing expectations doesn't necessarily mean reducing expectations. When you change expectations, you look for a different model. And if you look for a different model that says you're not going to commute many hours, you're going to be saving your time, your energy, that's a benefit that one can have that can potentially offset some of the other things you may think are a little less convenient, because you're gaining time, which is a precious commodity.
Are there some existing communities or developments that you gentlemen can point out as potential successes, as models for this type of behavior?
San Francisco's a great model. It's a great city. Come on, everybody. We know this.
Okay, go ahead. It's phenomenal.
Well, I was just at a conference actually yesterday in Santa Fe, where I just came from, folks from Sonoma County. where they're talking about the kind of models that you're talking about, putting together regional models of appropriate development and scenarios to get greenhouse gas emissions reductions down, but on a regional scale. And the conference was really well attended, but again, it was led by communities in California. So in fact, the country looks west many times for the models that we're going to replicate throughout the country, and I think hopefully this is the case again.
There are other good models. Portland, overused, but reasonably so, oversighted. I mean, mm-hmm. they set not only urban growth boundaries but standards for transit-oriented development and building energy efficiency. And on a per capita basis, they've seen since 1996 a decline in vehicle miles traveled on average per household, whereas the rest of the nation, it continues to climb. And it's because they've built a regional system that allows people some real choices about how they get around.
Yeah, transit-oriented development is key. You've got to do transit-oriented development.
Now, that's easy to say here, where we have some transit.
Yeah, that's right.
What about places in L.A. or even down the road in San Jose? It's really tough to get around down there.
Oh, you know, actually, you'd be surprised about L.A. They have a plan for extending their light rail, extending their commute train system, and adding BRT transit lines along the old avenues that used to carry those streetcars that you saw in Who's Afraid of Roger Rabbit? You know, it's a classic seminal movie about what we did to our heritage. And that they can infill around those systems. I mean, ironically, L.A. started as a streetcar city,
right,
and it will return to a streetcar city.
The bus rapid transit is a really great alternative, and it's a lot less expensive than building
rail.
I mean, there are some great examples in other parts of the world, in South America, where there are cities that have built their whole transportation system around
buses.
Yeah. Bus rapid transit.
But again, in the U.S., that's a change in expectation because we're not as much of a bus culture as we may have been in a different time.
But if you had dedicated bus rapid transit where it's a lane that's only for buses that operates at the same speed as Muni or BART.
David, you dress it up like a light rail. You make it look like light rail, and then everybody gets comfortable. That's basically the solution.
Then they won't notice the difference.
They don't. I mean, who knows what happens. But, you know, it's interesting. Before, we were talking about what is the most tenacious problem here. And it kind of goes to Ed's domain in this discussion, which is we can see a path, and quite frankly, given congestion and the cost of building new roads and the cost of gas as it's going to, you know, it will escalate. I think you can begin to be sanguine about, and also the desirability about not being trapped in your car all the time. You can be pretty sanguine about some pretty profound changes in travel behavior. The problem we have, at least that I've, you know, and you touched on it a little bit, is this existing building stock is hard to change. And it's hard to find the right incentives to change it, and it's a energy hog. And the rental housing stock and the commercial housing stock, where the landlord passes all those energy costs on to the tenants and, you know, can't see any return, even though they get a, you know, 5-year payback, they don't get the money to justify that investment. That is a really difficult problem I see.
It's the elephant in
the
room.
I need Ed to solve this.
Well,
how do we fix that?
It's the elephant in the room. Just building operations.
Ed, it's the room we're sitting in, actually.
It's the room we're sitting in, too. But existing building operations is 42% of everything. It's all the energy we consume is our existing buildings. So we can talk about all sorts of other issues, but unless we get a handle on that, that number is going to keep escalating every time we add a building, whether it's location efficient or not.
Yeah.
And whether we're using rapid transit or not. So we need to get a handle on that, but we also need to get a handle on both anything we build new and this huge building stock that we have. The only way that we're going to get a handle on the existing building stock that we have, the only way we're going to get a handle on that is through two things. One is some regulation, and I think that's going to happen, and two is incentives, because if you don't incentivize it, people are just not going to do it. There are two ways, I think, to incentivize it. One is the cost of energy goes up, and you increase the cost of energy by a number of mechanisms, or you create incentives for people to do it so it becomes financially beneficial to someone to actually address their buildings.
Now, there's some interesting examples, that at least out in the private sector and public-private partnerships, of buildings being renovated on a great scale, the Empire State Building being one of them. However, that's just one building landmark, though it is. How good is that at driving changes in behavior in buildings and people who operate them and own them? Well, not everybody can do that.
We need the examples, but an example here and an example there is not going to do it. We need massive examples. So that's why what we're advocating is let's bring the building sector back, but let's allocate about 70% of the resources we're going to use to bring it back toward existing building stock, and then the other 30% to new location efficient buildings, and then the rest to other building types, but really focus on first line existing buildings, and then second location efficient, so that we bring it back in a whole new way. The federal government, there are options out there where the federal government can provide incentives to people to do this and actually get paid back. This is not something that that needs to be a giveaway.
But how complicated is it for people to figure that out?
Actually, it's pretty easy. It's okay. Actually not very complicated.
Where should we send folks to figure that stuff out and to get a bead on it?
Well, you can go to our website, first of all,
architecture
2030.org. We have a plan
funny you should ask that.
I mean, we just there's a program that's now being considered by the White House that's called the 4.5 million jobs plan. It's how to bring jobs back in the building sector by incentivizing the building sector to bring it back in a whole new way. And it doesn't cost the federal government anything. They put the incentives out there, and then they get the money back through another revenue stream, which is the tax base, because they've created jobs, and they get the money back through another avenue. So in essence, they actually make $2 for every dollar they expend, and you begin to incentivize the private sector to loosen its purse strings to do the right thing. And it's on the website. So it's all explained there.
You know, I think this is, you know, talk about a political football, but the idea of green jobs isn't about importing solar collectors from China, which is where they happen to build them now, because we decided
to default
on that industry, but actually just retrofitting, you know, going around caulk guns and insulation blankets and getting our buildings up to speed. I mean, it's a fabulous... You know, it's a no-brainer, but of course, we saw what happened to the person who was going to lead that effort in Washington.
It is really difficult. It's simple, but it's difficult to get people to understand how to unlock that. I remember Bill Clinton at a recent talk he gave in Nevada, saying, "We have 7 million people out of work, 15 million people looking for jobs." And we're piddling around with a billion here and a billion there, and we have this building stock that we have to renovate. And the other notion is this whole notion that Peter just brought up of green jobs,
right?
That we're going to create green jobs. Well, we have 1.7, I think we calculated, some figures if you go on the government website is 1.2, but we think it's 1.7 million construction workers out of work. That's plumbers, electricians. You give them a set of drawings to renovate a building, and they build it to the drawings. They don't need special. They're all trained to do this already, so there's no special green jobs training that we need to get our building sector back to work. We just have to provide the drawings to get the buildings back up to speed and
give them a project and they can get it done.
That's exactly correct.
Is there a mechanism right now in San Francisco for that type of action, whether it's the Conservation Corps or some other unit?
Well, there's a very active Conservation Corps in San Francisco. There's also workforce development work, which is running through the Human Services Agency in San mm-hmm. Francisco, which is embarking upon a whole litany of projects. So there are, certainly are places to go where this type of work is being done. It's unfortunately not being done on a large enough scale yet. And that's where it needs some coordination and some specific funding. But there's a Jobs Now program, there's a the Conservation Corps.
There's the California Job Corps that was created earlier this year.
There's a California Job Corps, yes, absolutely. So there is on a small scale, there are things within San Francisco that can be used for this type of project. It's just not being directed or coordinated or organized in a large enough way to make an impact yet. But it's something that needs to happen, and it is an ideal time where there is this large pool of talent out there that can be utilized to do things that need to happen. And that's a thing that needs to happen as a result of some political pressure and organization so that the funding that the federal government is putting out there is actually used for things that are really beneficial in the long run. I think one of the failings of the stimulus plan is that everything went to shovel-ready projects.
Yeah.
And that didn't mean that they're good projects. It just meant they were ready to go.
Well,
and so much money went to things that, frankly, we shouldn't be spending money on.
Well, what the federal government did with the stimulus is it put money into shovel-ready projects. It gave money to the states and funneled it to the cities also. And what they did is used it directly for construction on state buildings, on city buildings, on roads, on lighting systems. It was a dollar in and a dollar spent, and then a dollar gone, in a sense. Not that these projects on schools and city buildings is not important, but what happened is there was no leverage of the funds. It was a dollar in, a dollar spent. They didn't leverage any. Hold on, let me finish. They didn't leverage any private money, any private spending, for each dollar. They didn't tie the dollars to $10 of private. To get the $1, you have to do $10 of private spending. So the 30 or 40 billion total for construction projects was exactly that, 30 to 40 billion. And once it's spent, it's gone. Those people have one-time jobs, and then it's gone, unless the economy turns around.
So you know, what you're saying is if you don't have smart planning or smart coordination, you're never going to get the smart buildings to where they need to be.
The issue here with the stimulus is deeper than that. Yeah, there was leverage, there was not leverage, but there were no new standards. Basically, the dollars that went out transportation infrastructure went to highways. Mm-hmm. The same old road building standards to lay out more asphalt across the countryside. And they didn't set a specific program to spend dollars on building retrofit and energy conservation. It was a huge opportunity lost. And, you know, on the one hand, we can all sit on this panel and say, we have a fabulous opportunity, everything's going to get better, you know, and we know exactly how it's going to get better. But if we don't confront the fact that there's tremendous political inertia and there's a bias towards repeating the past, whether it's roads or just building new inefficient buildings, that has to be dislodged, fundamentally dislodged. Spending more money doesn't get us where we need to go until you set a new direction. And I haven't seen a new direction set yet, to be really honest with you. I just got back from 3 days in Washington, D.C., and I talked to a lot of nice people who are very well-intentioned and understand all these issues very, very well. But they're scared of the conservatives in this country, and they're afraid to impart on a new direction. They're quite afraid. We see it in the health care bills. We see it in the way that the climate bill is being shaped. It's not aggressive enough. We know that. It's not aggressive enough. Transportation bill has been put off for 2 years. And that's where we actually need to realign highway spending to transit spending. And yet, there's very timid baby steps.
Well, Peter, what you're talking about is giving people a great big kick in the rump there to get them going. So who's going to apply the kick?
The audience? Is that what you're pointing?
Us? Them? Where? Ed?
Well, let me, I'm just going to go back again to Peter's notion. There are two sectors. There's the public sector and the private sector. Most of the money went into the public sector. We needed some of that. The public sector was not dragging the economy down, but I think we needed to put some funds into the public sector so it didn't follow the private sector in tanking. The private sector, which was dragging the whole economy down, was not the sector that the stimulus looked at and affected, and that's where I think there was not much attention paid. And so I think we're still paying for that in terms of jobs lost, because that's where most of the jobs are. So while we've shored up the public sector, which is only a very small part of the total U.S. sector, the private sector is like 90% of the whole of the building sector. That's the sector we need to bring back. But again, as Peter said, we need standards when we bring it back. We just can't bring it, just give money and say, okay, just start building like we did in the public sector with roads and things like that. Although you got to give the federal government some credit, you know, on the schools. They wanted efficiency. They did the energy efficiency block grants to states. But unfortunately, we haven't addressed the sector that really is taking the economy down. What the feds did is they drove interest rates down for housing. Everybody refied. There was a refi frenzy. Usually when you refi, you do construction. Everyone wanted to pocket the savings, and nobody did any construction.
No, they did marble countertops instead of insulated windows. We know what they did with the money.
Hang on just 1 second. I want to remind the audience we're going to be taking questions very shortly.
And hot tubs. They didn't
hit the mic because Peter's going to keep on going.
They didn't tie it to the right standards, which I think is that's what you got at.
That's my point.
Okay, we're coming down to the point where we want to open it up to the audience. So you gentlemen have one piece of advice that you can give our listeners both here and over the air as to what they can do to get this going, whether it's a cosmic kick in the pants or something else. Take it away, David. What
become
can folks
involved,
do?
Become active, push for things, and whatever you push for, push for twice as much.
Okay, good. Peter.
I can't think of one thing to do. I'm sad. I just can't boil it down that far. I think there are many, many things that we have to do, both on personal level and on political level. And it's part of a whole system. It's not buildings or just transportation. It's both and open space and a bunch of other things. And, it's basically reconceiving the American dream, which is not one thing.
You can tell we haven't gotten Peter to focus yet. It's been 30 years now.
And, Ed, help us out of here.
We've been trying to get him to focus a little bit.
No, it's not going to happen at this point.
I think we need to follow federal legislation, get active, because that's where the big changes right now, they're going to set the direction for where we move in the country. And I believe we have to support the Waxman-Markey bill. We haven't taken an official position on that. We like certain parts of it, but it's my own conviction.
No, being forceful, are you? Haven't taken a position.
Well,
yet.
Our organization hasn't, but I have. So, and I think we have to follow the Senate portion of it and make sure. Right now, there are very strong parts of that. There are parts that haven't been filled in yet. They're basically placeholders. And we have to make sure that those placeholders meet the same kinds of targets that are on the House side, so that we get, when it goes to conference, we really get something that's strong.
Okay, folks, now's your chance to fire questions at these guys. And as you can tell, they're very voluble and they want to talk. So who's got a question for them?
We're volatile.
No, not vulnerable. Go ahead, sir. Please come to the mic.
Hi.
And so, 1 second before I get you to to identify yourself. So the audience who cannot see us knows, as a reminder to all of you, the program is presented by the Commonwealth Clubs in Forum, and tonight we're talking about redefining building growth. Build it green. Go ahead with your question.
Thanks. So we know we need all buildings to be net zero by 2030, but there are building types, hospitals, high-rises, where it's going to be a really big challenge, if not impossible. What do you all think about kind of expanding the definition to include zero-energy communities? What are some of the challenges there or the opportunities in moving beyond trying to define it just as a lot line building issue?
You know, I don't know if that's directed at me or Peter, but actually we issued a 2030 planning challenge a few years ago, it's been picked up, and it basically calls for what you're talking about. It calls for communities moving in that direction towards zero net energy, so you can develop community-based energy systems, transportation systems, water systems. So it talks to all the things I think that Peter talked to, and the Congress for the New Urbanism adopted it, I think, about a year ago. And now it's part of their platform, and they're moving to get their membership to plan that way. So it's transportation, it's integrating transportation, buildings, water, infrastructure, all to move toward carbon neutrality by the year 2030, to move in that direction, both new projects and existing.
It's certainly a direction that we are as a city looking at as a direction that we want to go in, and it's certainly something that we've got some funding to do planning around it, to look at strategies, to come up with ways of heading in that direction.
I think it needs to be at the regional scale. I don't think each community needs to be zero net energy. There are many systems that operate at scales that are bigger than that. And so you need to think about it in that comprehensive sense.
Thank you. And you have a question, sir?
You mentioned that the path to reducing or to encouraging renovation in the existing building stock is either through regulation or incentives. And you mentioned that there's a fear that the conservative element of the country is squashed. It's creating fear about doing regulation. But I wanted to point out that even in Berkeley, where they were trying to do mandatory consumption standards for the city, that was shot down because in a very progressive community, because of the cost, it was going to, you know, it would cause homeowners and building owners. So it's more than just the conservative element. It's anything that costs people money, they will react negatively to. So how do we overcome that barrier? Is it education? Is it? I mean, what is the mechanism there?
You know, some would debate whether Berkeley is truly progressive or just wants to think of itself that way, and that's from somebody who comes from Berkeley. I think you make a really good point, which is always about the long term versus the short term. People think short term, and we need long term thinking at this point. We need to make investments for the long term. And, you know, as we see in so many sectors here, education is another great example. It's a long-term investment. We don't seem willing in this state to do that anymore. And so it does come back to financing. There has to be financial mechanisms to make the short-term, the long-term decision wise in the short term. And that's tricky business, but it can be done with the right mechanisms.
What do you think of the Berkeley First model, the creating a? What do you think of that model?
I think it's just a one-off look at me idea. It's, you know, it's very important that places try to pioneer things, and yet I don't think that they. That's not the scale at which we need to replicate the solution. You need larger systemic solutions.
Such as?
Well, we need to make a decision, number one, to house all the people who work in the Bay Area in the Bay Area. That's a beginning point. We need to make a decision in this country to invest more in transit than we do in highways. We need to make a decision to invest in building rehab and conservation instead of just building more utility facilities, more power plants. Those are all fundamental systemic investment choices that need to be made. And they're made at a fairly large scale,
actually.
Why
don't you jump in and then we'll take
the next question. Yeah, he makes a good point. You can't just impose restrictions and on the building sector, people will just go scream bloody murder. So what you have to do is incentivize those so that you get enough examples out there in the short run, in the very, very immediate future, that you get a large movement in that area, and then you can kick in different standards and better standards, because now you've moved the whole market in that direction. To just say we're going to move the market in that direction without the incentives, it'll backfire.
Okay, we have just under 10 minutes, and we have four people lined up for questions. And you know, I think we can do this, gentlemen. Go ahead.
2 minutes each.
How can we combat NIMBYism when the planning process typically pits one special interest group, the project sponsor, against another special interest group, the immediate neighborhood? How can we find a solution that's a win-win for the whole community as a whole?
So you're talking about interest-based
you want to start on
there?
That? I want to follow up on it.
All right.
Why don't you start?
Y'all can follow
I'll start on it.
You just need to be brief. Go ahead, David.
No, actually, I'd like Peter to address
it. Lobbing it back, are you?
Yeah. There are good examples, Portland, Washington State, even Salt Lake, that have done progressive regional plans that say, we really need the housing to locate here because of transit, because of compactness, because of open space preservation. The regional entity sets the larger standard. The local entity then figures out the details of it, not the if or. The problem right now is that we have piecemeal local planning. Each jurisdiction is absolutely in control, and it doesn't have to live up to any of the larger needs, whether they're affordable housing or workforce housing or what have you. So you need a certain amount of regional structure to basically come in and say, okay, each city, you figure out where to put it, but you need to provide this much housing at these economic levels so that we can balance jobs and housing in a rational way. That's not a lot to impose from the regional scale to the local. And as a matter of fact, I think when we're all done with AB 32, our energy standards for the state and SB 375, we're going to arrive at that. And so it's going to... You can't take away local control, but you can basically direct it and say, work within these parameters, because these parameters are what are healthy for the region and the environment as a whole.
And just a 10-second addition to that, it's looking at it on a larger scale as opposed to the really small local scale that will help result in solutions.
Just curious if any of you could talk to the Treasure Island project. It's one of the 16 Clinton climate positive development projects in the world, and where that's at as far as its development.
The Treasure Island program? The Treasure Island project, we're actually pretty familiar with that. And it's moving ahead in a very sustainable way. It's interesting that we have addressed the issue of density versus open space there in what I think is a very good way, in that the developer is now pushing for more density to give more open space to the project so it accomplishes both. There are issues around transportation. It's been like a five-year process that's nowhere near finished. It's about two-thirds of the way through to the point where we're going to start seeing some major construction there. But I certainly offline, I can give you lots of information on Treasure Island.
The problem with Treasure Island is that it's an island.
Yeah. The transportation issue is a big one.
Yeah.
And it's on an island that's attached to a bridge.
Yeah.
So ferry service is what's being looked at.
Yeah.
Okay. Good question. Next.
Hi. There's a lot of new materials that are coming out, especially green materials in buildings. But we don't really know, what's good or what's not. I think the California Solar Initiative really helped in terms of reducing confusion and putting certain products out there and rating them so that everybody is kind of on a level playing field. How can you do a similar thing with new green building materials and help educate everybody, contractors and everybody, in terms of what to use?
Ed, would you mind taking that one?
Well, I'm not sure locally what you're doing here, but at the national level, I think the key organization that's looking into materials, the U.S. Green Building Council, and then giving, having a system of rating those materials so you know what you're getting. You know if they're performing, what their embodied energy is and how we can bring that down. So that there really are truly green materials, that they can be recycled. There are all sorts of issues associated with that. I think that's just beginning to happen. I think there's a lot of greenwashing out there, obviously. And I think it's going to be up to an organization that is national in scope to be able to do that, because obviously materials, there's no boundary, state boundary. Materials flow throughout the country and actually globally. It's going to be an issue. It's going to be an issue in Copenhagen, I think, because we've shipped a lot of our dirty industry overseas, and we're bringing back the products. So the pollution is still happening, and that's a big issue. And people are talking about this. There's no resolution yet, but that has to be dealt with.
We have way too many labeling systems, over 300 that we're aware of, and what we need is fewer labeling systems. Yeah. And
better standards.
Better standards. Well, just fewer labeling systems would help to begin with.
Thank you. And you?
Hi. Following up the conversation on the long-term thinking and the embodied energy, what do you think the stance should be on the low-probability, high-impact events such as earthquakes and floods, which will have a tremendous carbon impact if they happen, but it's a little harder to embed them into policy. So what would be your stance on that?
Well, there's a certain amount of sea level rise now that's built into the system. There's a certain amount of temperature rise that's built into the system. We're right now at about 7/10 of a degree centigrade above pre-industrial levels. The conventional thinking is that if we stop building altogether and stop adding emissions, we're going to 1.3 degrees centigrade, and we're trying to keep below 2 degrees centigrade as a global standard and accomplishment. We've got 5 minutes left. Now exactly. I forgot. What was the question?
Well, I was addressing more the issue of if an earthquake were to happen, the buildings were to fall down.
So there were all sorts of issues with climate change, and so we need new planning strategies, basically, new planning and building strategies to anticipate what's coming down the line. Weather events are expected to be a little different. The West is expected to dry out more. We have coastal regions that are more prone to sea level rise and stronger weather events. Resiliency is going to have to be built in to both our building codes and our way of thinking when we begin dealing with the built environment. We're going to have to deal with those issues now so that they don't become liabilities in the future.
And if I could just add on the earthquake, on the earthquake issue, that's one thing that we've spent a lot of time thinking and planning around what we do if there's a major catastrophe and we have to deal with an enormous amount of debris and we want to make sure that that doesn't end up in a landfill. That takes an enormous amount of planning to make sure that there are facilities available, accessible, and usable in the case of a disaster to be able to take those materials and not have them go to landfill and have them go somewhere where you can reprocess them and use them for the rebuilding. So it's a big issue that we're very concerned about. We know it's inevitable. We just don't know when it's going to happen. And we need to be prepared for that so that we don't end up creating a whole lot of waste that helps nobody.
I got an idea. We could use it to build levees for the sea rise.
The interesting thing is that you not only have buildings, but we've been talking about planning quite a bit. Planning is going to have to be thought of very, very differently. For example, just take wetlands, for example. When you get sea level rise, the wetlands have to begin to move. They have to begin to migrate in order to maintain themselves, and they migrate inland. So now when you're planning around coastal communities, you need now wetland corridors. You have to make room for these things to to move. So there's all sorts of planning issues now that are surfacing that we never even conceived of before because of what's going to be coming down down the line. And if we don't take them into account now, then we lose those resources because they can't maintain themselves.
But you know, it's easy to use sea level rise as a kind of signature caricature of climate change and a big issue. But the reality is, for many urban areas, and I've looked at your maps of the inundations, that can and will be solved with levees. We will protect the cities and the building fabric and the homes that we have. There's no question about that. The harder problem is the drought, the water, the impacts on agriculture and our capacity to continue to feed the planet, and storm events and things like that. That, you know, I think, but it's hard to, you know, as you say, I have a hard time focusing. It's hard to focus on one single problem when you think about the huge array of issues that are going to emerge from climate change.
Peter, I want to give this gentleman a chance to ask his question. It's the last one of the evening. Please go ahead.
Thanks. So it's actually a transition from that, and it's basically we've been working a lot in ecosystem services or green infrastructure and water, and it seems as compared to materials and energy, those are the hardest to incentivize or even to value economically. So I was just curious as to whether you guys see certain groups or agencies really starting to convince the government of ecosystem services or those things like wetlands that are, you know, extremely expensive if we destroy them.
David, Ed, then Peter.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really difficult problem. I mean, our water, for example, for San Francisco gets stored in snow in the Sierras. If the snow disappears, we don't have that water storage system anymore, and we won't have enough water. And how do you price that, and how do you, and that is something that you can't, there's no easy fix to that. If temperature goes up and there's no snow, it's gone. There's nothing to do about that. So it's a really almost an intractable problem in the current context. So you have to start to figure out new ways to evaluate and value and integrate the costs of not doing things into the costs of doing things. And that's really the challenge that we have. We've got to be able to figure out a way that we look at what happens if we do nothing. Here's what it's going to cost. Now, here's what we should spend to make sure that doesn't happen. And it'll be cheaper to do that than to let it happen.
Okay, we've got 1 minute. I got the signal. Who wants to take the last comment, Ed or Peter? You can fight over the microphone.
He's taller.
Okay.
I think just to finish up on your question is, I think you're talking about value, and are we going to begin to put a value on those kinds of issues and services? I think you're seeing that happen now. I personally attend quite a number of conferences. I'm asked to speak, and you get a sense of what's going on in the country. There's a lot of talk now about environmental systems and ecosystems and preserving these systems and what needs to happen. I was just at a conference, again, in the Southwest, we deal with issues of water, and now we're talking about storing water at higher elevations rather than moving that storage up so you get less evaporation, and so you begin to address that situation. You look at a whole number of things. So I think that field is now gonna explode, actually.
Thank you all. Let's give a big hand for the panelists. Again, they are Ed Mazria, Peter Calthorpe, and David Assmann. And thank you for listening to us this evening. And now this meeting of Informant and the Commonwealth Club is adjourned for the evening. And I get to hit the gavel one more last time. And we're out.
I love that gavel.